Given that we live in the era of technology, I'm determined to make the best of it, or the worst of it, in the fact that I have a PowerPoint presentation, a subject on which opinions are divided, perhaps not, perhaps everyone thinks PowerPoint is an invention of the devil. But with the aid of these various devices, it is a pleasure to come and talk about the general subject of interprovincial free trade and set the stage for my far more learned colleagues to talk about the details. It's kind of a bittersweet pleasure, which is not unusual in Canadian public policy, because we're here to talk about something, a welcome policy change that's 100 years overdue. And one of the things that I want to do in my speech, therefore, in order to inject a certain note of hope and of levity into the proceedings, is to try to dispel a prevailing mood of yes, we can't that too often exists in Canada, including when it comes to things like constitutional freedom, freedom of trade, freedom from unreasonable search and seizure, all these other sorts of things that in point of fact, we are part of our heritage in a way that I think is not always understood. When it comes to internal free trade, this isn't just an idea whose time has come. I say it is an idea that came in 1867. And we are, of course, getting some help now from the courts, which in some ways is I regard as an unusual development, no offense to those in the legal profession. And obviously this this Como case, which you're all familiar with, is a really positive development. But if I could just take a step back here, how weird is it that it would require a lengthy, expensive, arduous court proceeding of the sort that most people have neither the time, the financial resources, or the psychological energy to engage in before a man could take legally purchased beer to his house? You know, how weird is it that this would be seen as some sort of affront to the community and to the benevolent state that protects us from enjoying desirable products made by our fellow citizens? You know, I can assume that to this audience that's rather peculiar. But you know, there's another audience to whom it would have been very peculiar as well, and that is the founders of Canada. The people who gathered in Charlottetown and Quebec City, the people who debated and voted on Confederation in the various legislatures. When I first really got involved in this back in 2010 when I co-authored this paper with Brian Lee Crowley, and this was for the fledgling MacDonald Laurier Institute, which is now, of course, in full flight over Ottawa, along with the late Robert Knox, who spent years inside the, you know, it's always tempting at a moment like this to say the government, but I'm going to be precise. Robert spent years inside the executive branch, one of three branches of government in this country as elsewhere, trying to bring about greater interprovincial free trade, working on the agreement on internal trade, and eventually realized that the problem was that he was trying to bring this about from within the branch of government most resistant to implementing the policy he was working on and most vulnerable to the siren song of protectionism. You know, and in the paper, we put forward what I like to think of as the familiar argument against protectionism, which is that it stands economics completely on its head. It thinks, next slide, that the point of production is to give us an opportunity to work and not the other way around. It values effort and despises results. You know, Henry Hazlitt said in Economics in One Lesson that if we really wanted to create jobs, we could simply ban the carrying of goods in trucks and make it all be carried around on our backs. And but by the same argument by which protectionism, you know, this idea that trade is a brawl in which we cheer when our stuff beats up the foreigner stuff and we're unhappy and ashamed if foreigner stuff beats our stuff. In point of fact, if we could just send people pictures of monarchs or politicians endlessly and they would send us stuff, we'd be happy people. We'd have lots of stuff and we could just get all kinds of things from these chumps out there. The problem, of course, is that sooner or later what they insist on is giving back the bits of paper and getting stuff from us. Trade is about getting things that we genuinely value. And you know, as Adam Smith said, those who put forward protectionist arguments are by no means such fools as those who believe them. That protectionist arguments originate with people who are seeking to enrich themselves through the state at the expense of consumers. And you know, they think they can become absolutely richer, but the more a society succumbs to protectionism and the slower growth becomes, in the end they get a relatively larger slice of the pie, but the pie is so much smaller that they even end up worse off. Protectionism is one of these lose-lose kind of deals that somehow succeeds very well in the political arena despite its negative impacts. And I remember I once tried to make this point in a graduate seminar because one of our textbooks had said something exceptionally obtuse about trade. And I said, well, what about Ricardo and you know, the gains from trade? And everybody looked at me blankly, including the professor, who was a very bright and well-informed person. And I said, imagine that you have two countries and two products. And the professor said, whoa, this is getting out of hand here. And even then, I realized that it would contribute neither to collegiality nor to my grade to say, hang on, I just did 2 + 2 and you're lost. So I buttoned my lip. But it did occur to me then that people are less familiar with this argument than they ought to be. And the delusion of what Herb Stein called economic skinheads is so strong internationally that almost the only way you can get free trade deals is to treat removing barriers to trade as a concession in return for their concessions. As opposed, you know, I'll stop hitting myself if you stop hitting yourself. Why don't you just stop hitting yourself? It hurts, right? And it's so strong that when we wrote the paper in 2010, it's okay, we tried to find a definitive list of all the interprovincial trade barriers in Canada, and we discovered they were so numerous and so insidious that it was impossible even to tally them all. Which tells you what will happen if protectionism is not prohibited fairly robustly in a constitution, which of course the United States Constitution does. They have this clause that Congress has the power to lay and collect taxes and duties. They have to be uniform within the United States, and Congress can actually enact the laws. And this has worked. One of the terrible lessons from the Articles of Confederation period was that the states would engage in trade wars if they could. So the Americans brought this in 1789, and it's worked ever since. The Australians also have one, which is perhaps less wordy, though the United States Constitution is not a wordy document. And again, this has worked. Australia may have its discontents and problems, but interprovincial trade barriers, or interstate trade barriers in their case, aren't one of them. So you think, well, if only we had one. But of course we do. And it is, I think, as clear and unambiguous as any of the others. If our founders didn't spell it out in more detail, the reason is they didn't think it was controversial. They understood this argument for free trade that baffled my graduate school colleagues, as they understood a lot of arguments for liberty much better than we tend to think nowadays. Somehow we've become attached to this notion of our country as an unprincipled compromise by inebriated hacks. And we're proud of that. Bob Stanfield said, Canada works as long as we don't stop to think why it works. Well, I don't agree with that. And those of you, it's nice to be in front of an audience full of Runnymede Society members in that you'll be interested in my documentaries. We've got the one on Magna Carta, one on fixing the Constitution, one on Canadians' right to self-defense. And they're for sale. The problem is if you're law students, you have no money. They're also available on YouTube free. So, you know, those of you who would like to support our work by buying a DVD, please do so, or paying for a digital download. If not, you can watch them on YouTube. But they make the argument that we are part of this long tradition of liberty under law coming out of Magna Carta and even before. And that our founders, in fact, were absolutely and consciously dedicated to this tradition and wrote us a constitution in 1867 that limited government. They gave us a constitution similar in principle to that of the United Kingdom, which at first glance you think they must have been really, really hammered when they said that, because obviously our constitution is federal and written and the British one is unitary and not all written in one place. But that's not what they meant. What they meant, they were thinking about a United Kingdom in which government was very small, 10% of GDP, where citizens' rights were secure, where there were no restrictions on gun ownership in Victorian England, none whatsoever, and in which the people through the legislative branch kept the executive branch under control. That's what they meant to give us. And in a very large measure, that is what they gave us. And people don't know this partly because our founding debates were out of print, essentially, until 1999 when Janet Eisenstadt, Bill Gairdner, Paul Romney, and Ian Gentles produced them unlike the American Federalist Papers, which of course Sir John A. Macdonald carried a well-read copy of with him to Charlottetown and to Quebec City. But our founding fathers were very clear on the fact that Canadians were a free people and ought to be a free people. If you read those debates, it's astonishing to hear speaker after speaker hailing liberty as the central Canadian value. And basically the argument over confederation is between people saying preserve your British liberty, join confederation, and people saying preserve your British liberty, don't join confederation. There's nobody out there saying, hey, no, we believe in big government. And when they talk about free trade, the title of we got our paper from, George Brown, saying, I go heartily for the Union because it will throw down the barriers of trade and give us control of a market of 4 million of people. And then he ridiculed the customs officers who harass you at every provincial border. And he says, the idea of confederation is to throw down all the barriers. Next slide. And make a citizen of one a citizen of all, including not just goods, but also all walks of life. That trades would not be restricted, that if he were certified in one province, you could practice in another province. This is absolutely what they wanted. Not on grubby material grounds, but on the grounds that Canada was to be a large stage on which people could pursue their dreams. There's a Newfoundland legislator, and they lost the debate in Newfoundland back then, but he said, our liberties would be vastly extended, and we should move in a grander, wider, and nobler sphere. And that is what the people who made Confederation had in mind. And can one imagine anything pettier than restrictions, interprovincial differences in how big those little coffee creamers are that sit on restaurant tables? I mean, it's preposterous. Whoever went to Manitoba, put cream in their coffee and went, oh, yuck, we got an extra milliliter back home. This is disgusting. It's simply to rip off everybody to enhance the prospects of dairy producers in that province, or the rules, different rules for bus breaks in Ontario and BC. And it goes on and on. You know, why can't a Quebec hairdresser practice in Alberta? What are they going to do? You know, shave a fleur-de-lis into your head? So I defer to my colleagues more later. One more slide. But I want to leave you the thought that Canada, the spirit of Canada is captured by Sir Wilfrid Laurier, our last founder and late to the party. Canada is free and freedom is its nationality. However bizarre that sentiment might seem if uttered in Parliament today, it was what the people who made Confederation had very much in mind and in their hearts. And so when they created that provision, S-121, they were unequivocally seeking to prevent the erection of trade barriers because they would make us poorer and they would make us smaller in every way. So this is not a departure from our tradition. Big government is a departure from our tradition in every imaginable dimension, including permitting interprovincial trade barriers, on which grounds I maintain that the Como decision was not just good economics. It was good constitutional interpretation, and it was faithful to our long tradition of liberty under law.
Good morning, everyone. I'm just getting over a slight cold, so if I sound raspier than usual, I apologize. As Joanna suggested, I'm here as the proverbial pinata, and I have no doubt after I'm done, Ian Blue's going to come up and tell me why I'm wrong. And so I would encourage all of you to ask questions afterwards, and specifically if you want to ask me the question, what I think of what he has to say, and that'll give me the right of reply. But I do want to emphasize, Ian Blue and I agree on a lot, and just to sort of sum it up, the traditional interpretation of Section 121 is that it only applied to essentially tariffs, and that any non-tariff barrier was okay. And in Como, the judge came along and he said, no, Section 121 encompasses non-tariff barriers as well. I agree with the judge in Como, I agree with Ian Blue that Section 121 essentially means what it says. It doesn't say admitted free of duty, it says admitted free. In my view though, Section 121 is essentially a reaffirmation of what's already there. And what is already there is a division of powers that places all power for trade and commerce in the federal government. So that means that the provincial governments already can't regulate interprovincial trade. And that same division of powers also precludes the provincial governments from levying indirect taxes. They can only levy direct taxes. Well, what are direct and indirect taxes? An indirect tax is one, in 1867, what it meant was that it would not be paid by the person who it was levied against. It would be passed on to the consumer. And what that means, among other things, is that provinces can't tax imports as they're coming in. Why? Because that would be an indirect tax that would get passed on to the consumer. So our division of powers already precludes provinces from doing what the New Brunswick legislature essentially did in the Como case. Now, the difference between what I'm saying and what Ian has said is that, in my view, Section 121 would not apply to Parliament. And that's because in Section 91, the section that gives Parliament the trade and commerce power, that section says that Parliament may pass laws notwithstanding anything in this Act, which would mean that, in my view, Section 91 is paramount to Section 121. So I'm just going to speak very briefly about that. I'm going to make two principal arguments. The first argument I'm going to make is that my interpretation of Section 121, in my view, is most consistent with the text and with the history and purpose of Section 121 and the division of powers. And secondly, I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to think that there's probably a few people here who are proponents of classical liberalism, and I'm going to say that my view of Section 121, though it seems to be more supportive of big government because it doesn't restrain Parliament, in my view, it's actually the interpretation that is more consistent with classical liberal principles. So just getting to the text very briefly, I agree with Ian Blue. The provision says admitted free. It does not say admitted free from duty. And that means that Section 121 does not just encompass tariff barriers. It has to encompass non-tariff barriers. But if we're looking at the text and we're adopting the ordinary meaning of the words, we have to look at the entire text. Now, if Section 121 was supposed to have been a restriction on federal power as well, and especially the federal trade power, you would think that it would not have been included in the section of the Constitution dealing with revenue. It probably would have been put into Part 6 of the Constitution. It probably would have been put into Section 91(2) as a subordinate clause. You could say Parliament has the power to regulate trade and commerce, comma, except you know, all goods shall be admitted free in between the provinces. It doesn't do that. Section 121 is in a completely different section of the Constitution. The other issue, as I alluded to before, is that Section 91 makes Parliament's powers paramount. It says that Parliament may legislate for trade and commerce, notwithstanding anything in this Act, which would include Section 121. Now, we can read those two together and we can say, well, Parliament's trade and commerce power has to be read in light of Section 121. That's true. But I would submit that if we're going to do that, you'd have to restrict the meaning of Section 121 back to tariff barriers. Because if Section 121 has a broad meaning and it applies to Parliament, it would essentially gut the trade and commerce power. It would strip it of about 50% of its content. And I would submit that if that was what the framers had actually intended, they would have put that restriction into the trade and commerce power itself. Now, when you look at the history of Section 121, in my view, it actually is very clear that it supports my interpretation. Section 121 did not appear until the fourth draft of the British North America Act. It was not in the Quebec resolutions that the Fathers of Confederation agreed to in 1864. It was not in the London resolutions of 1866. It was not in the first three drafts of the B&A Act. It shows up in the fourth draft. Now, you can say that doesn't matter because important things can come late in the game, and that's true. But in the case of the B&A Act, Section 121, in the case of the B&A Act, the entire Act was meant to reflect the Quebec resolutions. And Justice LeBlanc even talks about this in Como. He says, the British wanted the legislation to reflect the wishes of the Fathers of Confederation, mature and knowledgeable men who had a vision, who had the right to determine their own constitutional destiny, and who sought a self-governing, autonomous country that would continue to be part of the British Empire. In other words, the BNA Act was supposed to, with certain details changed, but it was supposed to be essentially a reflection of what the Quebec resolutions said. And the Quebec resolutions do not have any similar provision to Section 121. And this is very interesting because John was just showing you what George Brown said in the Canadian Legislative Assembly about how the proposal before us, and what he said was the proposal before us is to throw down all barriers between the provinces, to make a citizen of one a citizen of the whole. The proposal is that our farmers and manufacturers and mechanics shall carry their wares unquestioned into every village of the Maritime Provinces. And yes, he said this, and many of the other fathers of Confederation said things very similar. But they said this before Section 121 was ever drafted. They said this in 1864 and 1865. So where were they getting it from? Why did they think at this time that the proposal they had agreed to at Quebec already protected free trade between the provinces? Well, in my view, the only explanation is that they looked to the division of powers that they had established. They saw that they had given trade and commerce exclusively to what they called the general government, but what would become parliament, and that the provinces were precluded from therefore legislating in respect of interprovincial trade, and were also precluded from levying indirect taxes. And there is a statement that Alexander Galt, one of the founders, made in November 1864, where he essentially says this. He says, it was most important to see that no local legislature should by its separate action be able to put any such restrictions on the free interchange of commodities as to prevent the manufacturers of the rest from finding a market in one province and thus from sharing in the advantages of the extended union. There was nothing about Parliament, and we don't know this for sure, but my guess when you read through the historical record is that nobody thought Parliament was going to be infringing free trade. People were worried about provinces enacting protectionist measures, and Parliament was going to be allowed to regulate trade that was relevant for the whole Dominion. And I would say that, in general, that is basically what has ended up happening. We do, Parliament has passed some laws that have restricted free trade, but in general, most of these laws, and certainly the law that Mr. Como was charged under, was a provincial law. And it is the provincial laws that, of course, are going to hinder interprovincial trade the most. So I just wanted to speak now about what I see as the benefits of this interpretation. In my view, it is the most textually and doctrinally sound. But in my view, it's also the interpretation most consistent with classical liberalism. And that's the case for two reasons. One, we have a plethora of precedents in this country. Not only Gold Seal, we have many, many precedents in this country that stand for the proposition that Parliament can regulate interprovincial trade. This goes back to the Parsons decision of 1881. And that decision was not a centralist decision. In fact, in that decision, the Privy Council was limiting the trade and commerce power in favor of the provincial power over property and civil rights. And what he was saying is that all that's really left in this trade and commerce power is trade that is interprovincial, international, and that is for the general benefit of Canada. So we have tons of precedents in this country that have affirmed that Parliament can regulate interprovincial trade. And anyone who cares about the rule of law, a continuity of law, I would submit has to care about affirming these precedents. And generally speaking, old Privy Council precedents are good. They generally affirm limited government principles. If we adopt a rule that says precedents can be overturned very easily, which is essentially what the Supreme Court has done in Bedford, and which Justice LeBlanc piggybacked on in Como, and I would argue expanded when precedents can be overturned, if we do that, then we are leaving liable a lot of other good precedents to be overturned anytime a judge feels that way. Now, secondly, and this is, in my view, the most important point, that moving away from Section 121 returns us to the division of powers. And in my view, in recent years, the Supreme Court has changed our division of powers. They have started to talk about a flexible model where we encourage overlap, where, yes, the provinces can do this, but the federal government can do the same thing, and it's all one big happy family. It's almost a multiplication of powers instead of a division of powers. And this goes to what John's point is. I agree that our framers were proponents of limited government, and one of the ways that government is limited is by dividing powers between the federal government and the provinces. And the way that that is ensured is by looking at each of these powers exclusively, which is what the text says these powers are. The words exclusive or exclusively appear about eight times in that section of the Constitution. And the problem is when you look at the Como decision, Justice LeBlanc says, well, this is obviously not a division of powers case. This is a Section 121 case. Well, no, in my view, it is a division of powers case. You have a New Brunswick law that was clearly targeting importation. It talked about possession, but it was clearly targeting importation. You had the RCMP running a sting operation in Quebec over the border. So to say that this was not a division of powers question, in my view, is completely wrong. And so what we need to do, in my view, is return the conversation back to the division of powers. We need, and this will be assist us not only when it comes to interprovincial trade, it'll be a value in discussions about carbon regulations, about healthcare, even about freedom of expression. We do not talk about the division of powers enough, and we need to do so more. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm speaking from notes, and I have additional copies if anyone is at all interested. I wanted to say at the outset that CCF has done a wonderful thing by bringing this program together and letting us like-minded lawyers exchange ideas. I think it's very healthy for Canada and very healthy for the legal profession. I want to also say I'm happy that Asher Honickman and other scholars are thinking about the Como decision and about Section 121 again. That discussion, folks, is long overdue. Today I'm going to respond to Asher, but I do so in the spirit of exchanging ideas and debating contentions. Ultimately, we have to agree on where Section 121 fits into Canada's economic union. I also want to make the point that my good friend Arnold Schweizberg, who is sitting over here, was key to our win in our versus Como. Back in 2008, he was the one who inspired me to develop the case for Judge LeBlanc's interpretation of Section 121, and he brilliantly conducted the Como trial. So thank you, Arnold. I'm just moved to depart from my text to just think about one apocryphal story, and that is during the Yeltsin government in Russia, a Canadian firm was retained to draft a bankruptcy act for Russia. Once the Russian lawyer looked at it, he read it, understood it, went to see a judge, bribed the judge, and got a receiving order, put a company into bankruptcy. In Russia, receivers that are appointed have armed security guards. They rushed into a particular company and committed barratry. So it just shows you how what are clear rules can be changed by people who have different intents. And I thought of that story when Mr. Justice Joyal mentioned Section 7 of the Charter, and it's certainly what happened to Section 121 in the Gold Seal case. But Judge LeBlanc held that Section 121 permits the free movement of goods among the provinces without barriers, either tariff or non-tariff. Full stop. He did not restrict it to provincial trade barriers. He just said without trade barriers. And in doing so, he restored the status of Section 121 in Part 8 of the Constitution Act as a plenary and independent provision of our Constitution. Now, Asher sees Section 121 as being nothing more than an aid to interpreting the Federal Trade and Commerce Power under Section 91.2. And he sees it as applicable to provincial trade barriers only. He believes that the Trade and Commerce Power by itself is strong enough to provide Parliament with sufficient authority to prohibit interprovincial trade barriers, and that's why Section 121 should be married with it. Well, let's see how well the Trade and Commerce Power stands up, and Asher's argument that the Cuomo case was really a division of powers case. Now, Section 134B of the New Brunswick Liquor Control Act was the provision that we were challenging in the Cuomo case. And what it says is it's an offense to have liquor not purchased from the Provincial Liquor Commission. Asher believed we should have challenged Section 134 as violating the federal trade and commerce power, and that our whole Section 121 argument was really quite unnecessary. And he cited the 1971 Manitoba egg case. Now, Arnie and I did not make the trade and commerce argument for two related reasons. Reason number one, we were aware that since 1995, the Supreme Court of Canada, in a whole line of cases, has toughened the test for establishing interjurisdictional immunity. For example, in 2015, in Alberta versus Maloney, the Supreme Court of Canada said there is only a violation of interjurisdictional immunity, and I'm quoting, if the operation of the provincial law has the effect of making it impossible to comply with the federal law, or has the effect of frustrating Parliament's purpose. Only then do you have a violation of interjurisdictional immunity. So under the Maloney test, there was no conflict between Section 134B of the New Brunswick Liquor Act and federal jurisdiction under the trade and commerce power. Section 134 operates in perfect harmony with Section 3 of the Importation of Intoxicating Liquors Act, which says that all liquor entering a province must be sold to the Provincial Liquor Commission. So that's reason one, we didn't do the trade and commerce argument. Reason two, we were aware that the issue of whether the provision prohibiting possession of liquor not purchased at the Liquor Commission violated the federal trade and commerce power had been decided twice. In New Brunswick in 1974, the New Brunswick Court of Appeal said that 134B did not violate the trade and commerce power. In 1997, the Supreme Court of Canada in Ontario versus Air Canada versus Ontario held that the Ontario provision did not violate the trade and commerce power. So QED, the trade and commerce power by itself, in that case, was not sufficient to protect against interprovincial trade barriers. Now, Asher makes a historical argument. He referred to the Quebec resolutions of November 1864. And as we all know, they were a set of principles, including the Federal Trade and Commerce Principle, adopted by the Fathers of Confederation to be the basis for further discussing Confederation. Asher says, okay, the Quebec resolutions did not contain the principle found in Section 121, ergo, 121 can have been very important. But what that historical argument overlooks, my friends, is that in November 1864, thinking about Confederation was not frozen in amber. The evidence that Arnold Schweizberg adduced from Dr. Andrew D. Smith, Canada's foremost historian of the Confederation era, is that a great deal happened between November 1864 and March 29, 1867, when the British North America Act was proclaimed. The United States ended the Reciprocity Treaty, which increased the need for free trade among the British colonies. Elections were held in New Brunswick and Nova Scotia. There were negotiations with the British over the funding of the Intercolonial Railway. There were negotiations among the fathers and public statements about what source of revenue would replace lost colonial tariffs. There was the London Conference of 1866, which Asher has mentioned. And it was agreed in the London Conference that Sir John A. Macdonald would stay on in 1867 to work on the British North American Bill. All these events, all these intercommunications refined the Confederation proposals subsequent to November 1864. The historical argument also overlooks the fact that in drafting any piece of major legislation, and I've been involved in at least three of them, there are always matters that the policy makers never thought of that need dealing with. There are always important issues that have to be added to the bill at the last minute. And Section 121 was such a late addition. It came into the bill as an amendment made in the House of Commons to a bill initiated in the House of Lords. It was necessary because of this reason. It was apparent to everybody that the new Parliament of Canada would be dominated by a coalition from Ontario and Quebec. Without Section 121, Central Canada could use Parliament's trade and commerce power to interfere with interprovincial trade in a way that benefited residents there at the expense of other parts of Canada. Dr. Smith testified in the Como case that Section 121 was needed as a safeguard to prevent the federal trade barriers as much as it was needed to prevent provincial trade barriers. Therefore, the historical case for marrying Section 121 to 91.2 cannot be established. Now, Asher also relies on the textual argument that the notwithstanding phrase in the opening words of Section 91 of the Constitution Act means that Parliament's power to regulate trade and commerce trumps any limits set out in Section 121. Well, let's test that idea. If the notwithstanding phrase in Section 91 meant that the trade and commerce power trumped Section 121, it would also mean that it could trump any other provision of the Constitution dealing with business. It would mean that the trade and commerce power could trump Section 92.13. Property and civil rights in the province, or it could trump 92.16, matters of a purely local or private nature in the province, both of which provisions we know deal with business intimately. However, we all know that since Confederation, the courts have held that the federal trade and commerce power cannot interfere with those provisions. Well, then I ask you, if the notwithstanding phrase in Section 91 doesn't allow the trade and commerce power to change other provisions in the Constitution dealing with business, why then should it be interpreted as limiting Section 121? There's no case that holds that. Now, I want to say again, I welcome Asher's views. I also welcome the views of Professor Malcolm Lavoie and Professor Michael Marin of the University of Alberta Law School and the University of New Brunswick Law School, respectively. Their view is that the LeBlanc interpretation of Section 121 should be limited. And I simply say in response to that, that based upon the work that I, Arnold Schweizberg, and Dr. Andrew D. Smith have done, the view that Section 121 should be limited or restricted in any way is not supported by either history or the jurisprudence. But having said that, it's encouraging to see the Como case debated by the best in the academic and the constitutional community, and I enjoy the debate. We will see what will happen in the Supreme Court of Canada once they file an application for leave to appeal. Thank you.
I don't want to preempt Malcolm, but Malcolm's paper also suggests that Section 121 would not apply to the federal government, as I've said. So I'm not alone in making that argument, certainly. Just one response quickly to Ian's point. No one's doubting that a lot happened between 1864 and 1867, but when you see different drafts of the British North America Act, what we know actually is that the framers of the Act, MacDonald and the British framers, were trying to make the Act more centralist in nature. And at one point they even gutted completely the provincial residual power over matters of a local and private nature. So it seems counterintuitive to me that in the midst of trying to make the Act actually more centralist, they would have added a huge barrier to federal power, which, as Ian has just suggested, is a barrier that has no limitations whatsoever.
Thanks a lot for a really interesting panel. What I wanted to ask about is, ask each of you, if you would, to maybe reflect on the question of means and ends in strategic constitutional litigation. There are at least a couple of ways in which that comes up. One is, of course, the issue of stare decisis. The Como trial decision ended up with a result that many of us would like, but it did so using and potentially expanding the exception to stare decisis in Bedford and Carter, which sort of rule of law proponents might not like so much. So how do you make decisions about strategic decisions about that kind of thing? And the other way it comes up, I suppose, is the interpretation that you ask the courts to adopt. So you could ask for a more far-reaching interpretation of something like Section 121, that it rules out all non-tariff barriers, or that, or a far-reaching revision of the division of powers, as Asher has called for. But does it make more sense in certain cases to ask for something more incremental? An extension to some non-tariff barriers using some horrible balancing test or something. So any reflections you could have on those issues would be welcome.
Well, I would just say that I've made my comments not as a litigator, but as just someone who is, I guess, academically looking at the provision. I'm not at all faulting the strategy that counsel used in Como. It was obviously a great strategy, and Justice LeBlanc did what every lawyer loves, which is that he essentially adopted wholeheartedly what counsel was advocating, and that's what every lawyer wants to see. So depending on whether or not you're counsel versus if you're just making academic arguments, I think the strategy would have to be different. And I think in some cases, it depends on the judge, first of all, but in some cases you'd want to call for a more incremental approach. In some cases you would want to stay clear of trying to overturn any Supreme Court precedent. In some cases, maybe a more local precedent would be the one that you'd be fearful of overturning. So I think it's a case-by-case basis. I don't think there's necessarily one strategy that would always work, but I think Ian Blue's strategy certainly worked in the Como case.
Yeah, Professor Lavoie, I think that if the case does go to the Supreme Court of Canada, and from what we understand, the Supreme Court of Canada is quite interested in it. We will end up with an interpretation of Section 121 very akin to that of Mr. Justice Rand in the dissenting judgment in Murphy versus CPR, which is that you're free from barriers, tariff or non-tariff, except in minor matters. So. Picking liquor, for example, you might knock out Section 3 of the Importation of Intoxicating Liquors Act. That would allow private liquor stores, but they would still have to comply with all provincial licensing and other laws. It would not allow marketing boards, for example. Whether the Supreme Court of Canada will think broadly enough to do that, or whether it's going to be so parochial it wants to protect the Quebec maple syrup industry, that's something we'll have to decide. But I think that probably the way it's going to go forward is incrementally with court decisions on particular alleged trade barriers.
Yeah, I mean, I'm the wrong person to ask because I'm not a lawyer, but I am... I'm very much struck by the fact that we had this ruling in Scholey back in 2005 that seemed to make an enormous difference and then didn't. You know, nothing else has happened except for one case that's immensely bogged down in procedure. But I do think, when I look at this case, one of the things that impresses me is that the claim was a sweeping one of a sort that you might almost be embarrassed to bring into a court because it's so contrary to the way people often think about it, but it was made anyway and it worked. And that impresses me. And it reminds me of that quotation from Learned Hand that liberty lies in the hearts of men and women. And if it dies there, no law, no court, no constitution can save it or even do much to help it. And that's why I think it's very important within the legal profession. I'm so happy to see the Runnymede Society founded. And also in the broader public and why we do the work that we do, to convince people that freedom is not somehow un-Canadian. And that whether you're reading the text fairly strictly or whether you are attempting to implement prevailing social mores, you're still allowed to look favorably upon a claim that Canadians can in fact buy beer and take it home.
Thank you for a great presentation. I have a couple of questions. Actually, Asher, I have more than two questions for you, but I'll just stick to two. The first is, I'm going to ask for how you account for the following missing historical context in your suggestion that Section 121 does not impose a on federal powers. And it's this. And I'm going to describe for those of you who haven't had the opportunity to read the transcript of the examination of Andrew Smith during the Como trial. He recounted to us how, going into 1865, we were experiencing one of the most prosperous times in our country. Railroads were being built, banks were being built. It was a time of enormous economic development and sustenance in Canada. And all of that threatened to come to an end because the Americans wanted to abrogate the free trade agreement that was currently in place. And the Americans couldn't immediately abrogate that, they had to give notice. But during the notice period, they came up with a very crafty way of nevertheless implementing their intention. They started to incorporate non-trade barriers, or that which we now call non-trade barriers. For instance, if you're a merchant traveling from Montreal with your lettuce bound for Boston, well, they'd stop you at the border for lengthy inspections to such a degree that your lettuce wouldn't be good by the time you arrived in Boston. They insisted upon commercial documents and passports that never before were required. And the reaction of our fathers of Confederation was one of horror, absolute horror. They felt that they were going to lose the source of prosperity that had driven the economic engine of Canada at that time. And so not only were trade barriers immediately in the forefront of their mind, non-trade barriers all of a sudden by the spring of 1865, which had never really before been on anyone's radar because the Americans hadn't been doing this previously, all of a sudden became of paramount importance. And that's why a lot of these issues were raised in latter drafts of our Constitution, for example. So going back to my question to you, seeing the historical reasons why our founding fathers were so alert to the damage that non-tariff barriers could cause in Canada and their determination to create a true free trade zone within our country to make up for the perceived loss of free trade with the United States. How do you account for that in your suggestion that Section 121 does not impose a fetter on federal powers?
Well, I would say, first of all, I don't disagree with a lot of what you're saying about what our fathers of Confederation were thinking about at that time. But I think we always have to be careful, and I think even Dr. Smith would concede this. I haven't read the transcript, but I'm sure he would concede that we don't know exactly what each founder thought about that issue, about other government issues, and to the extent that they believed it. I mean, we know that the founders were generally believers in limited government, and yet they did not enact any other limitations on government in the division of powers the same way that the U.S. Constitution has certain limitations built into it. Pretty much our founders were believers in limited government, but they were also sort of conservatives in that Burkean tradition. I don't think they were libertarians, and all the case law that came out soon after Confederation occurred dealing with alcohol, none of the cases at that time were suggesting that the federal government could impose limitations on what it could do with alcohol trade. And in fact, it was the opposite. That's when we get all the initial double aspect cases where you know, both the provinces and the federal government can impose restrictions on alcohol. So I think it is, it's not wrong certainly, but it's not complete just to say that the framers believed in unfettered free trade, therefore they would have stopped Parliament from enacting trade barriers. I think they did believe in free trade. I think they thought they had solved the problem by confining free trade only to the federal government. And I think all I can surmise, and none of us will ever know this, but all I can surmise is that they didn't believe that Parliament presented a threat to internal free trade in the Dominion, that threat came from provinces who would jealously guard their resources.
Second question.
Okay.
You mentioned the continuity of law. Does that mean we're bound by our mistakes, no matter how old they are?
No. I think there should be a test to overturn any precedent, and there have been various tests. And I'm not suggesting that Gold Seal should not have been overturned, and there's a lot of persuasive arguments that have been made on why it should be overturned. I'm simply saying that precedents do have inherent value. Continuity of law, predictability, all of this has a lot of value, and that we have to be very careful whenever we're going to overturn a precedent. Under my proposal of Section 121, you wouldn't need to overturn the Gold Seal precedent because Gold Seal concerned a federal law. But my point was less about Gold Seal and more about the many other cases that have commented on interprovincial trade, and that that is one of the things that Parliament can do.
So to wind up the two questions then, are you suggesting that the federal government is free to enact a non-tariff trade barrier that affects interprovincial trade?
Well, it would depend on the individual law, but generally that's the power, I believe, that they have under the Trade and Commerce Power to erect regulations pertaining to interprovincial trade. I mean, I'm not saying anything novel here. This is, like I said, this goes back almost the entire length of our country's history is when the Privy Council made that determination that the federal government, that trade and commerce power, it is very narrow, but it does apply to interprovincial trade. And by the way, that's going to Ian's comment that the notwithstanding clause would mean that trade and commerce would overrule property and civil rights. Well, the reason it doesn't is because the power is construed narrowly and the property and civil rights power is construed broadly. So they don't actually overlap. So it's not that trade and commerce trumps property and civil rights, it's that they don't actually ever end up colliding. But the courts have said from the beginning that the notwithstanding clause makes the trade and commerce power and the other powers in Section 91 paramount. So, and again, I'm not saying anything that hasn't been said by the Supreme Court and the Privy Council on dozens of occasions.
I want to add a couple of thoughts based on this discussion. And one of them is to bear in mind that the people like Sir John A. Macdonald were very impressed by the fact that the freest country in the world by a very wide margin was Britain, which was a unitary state. And the history of the development of freedom in Britain in large measure was of the increasing power of the populace through Parliament to restrain the executive, which is what happened, you know, even before there was a Parliament in Magna Carta, and then through the development of the independence of the House of Commons, control of its own procedure, through the 17th century, the English Civil War, and then the Glorious Revolution. And so there were certain troubling trends in the growing supremacy of Parliament that were not visible to the founders of Confederation that have become very major in the 20th century, including that if you listen to the debate, for instance, on control of firearms early on in the after Confederation, it is widely assumed that the government cannot, in fact, bring gun control in Canada because the British Bill of Rights guarantees the Protestant subjects the right to bear arms. So it was assumed at the time that there were guarantees of rights that stood above the legislature and could not be overridden by it. And so that to say the Founding Fathers were not libertarian, by modern standards, I would think that they were on the extreme libertarian wing. They would be horrified, any of the people who made Confederation, to see what governments got up to in this country by the 1960s, let alone today. It never occurred to them they were creating a state capable of doing any such thing. And when it comes to precedent, I've, as a non-lawyer, precedent's a very interesting thing, because my view is if the judge decided it wrong, obviously we need to overturn it. Why on earth should we be stuck with some group of judges' wacky reading? But again, to go back in history, one of the puzzling things about our constitutional order, if you look at law at the time of Magna Carta, when Henry II, the almost great, codifies English law, we all think laws come from legislatures. But there were no legislatures. Where did England get its common law? And what Henry did is he sent his judges out. He was having this kind of power struggle with the nobility over who would administer justice, and Henry cheated. What he did is he had courts that were fairer, and this just undermined the nobility. Because what they did is they went around and they inquired, what is the law under which you have always agreed to live? And then they figured out what the law was, then decided the case based on law, and then they codified it. So that what you had was precedents that were arising not from the musings of philosopher kings, but from the people. Judges were not making law in the sense that they decided what it was. Judges were finding out what the people had agreed to. And precedents like that, that are so deeply dug in and arise out of popular sovereignty, ought not to be tampered with. But it's a very different matter when judges decide that they are sociologists who can give orders to the police. And so I don't think that we should have a great deal of respect for precedent that arises from what I would, you know, it's a cliche, but a lot of it's social engineering. That's a very different matter than not saying you're not secure against unreasonable search and seizure because an Englishman's home had been his castle for centuries when Edward Cook coined the phrase. So I would not have much respect for bad precedent. We want certainty, but we want certainty that they're reading the law properly and that in terms not just of the text but also of the spirit, that Canada is meant to be a free nation in which citizens are masters of the government and not the other way around. Because otherwise you have rule by law but not rule of law. And that is a very, very bad thing.
Thank you. I promise to only ask one question. I wanted to address this to Ian Blue, if I could. Your argument makes the assumption that there are provisions in the British North America Act which bind both the federal and provincial governments or legislatures, thereby having the effect of saying that no legislation can be passed in this area. My understanding is that the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council in a ruling of, I forget the exact date or the name of the case, but I believe it was around 1908, 1910, ruled that unless a power had been specifically reserved for the Imperial Parliament, all of the conceivable powers on which legislation could occur were delegated either through the Act, either to the provincial legislatures or to the national parliament, and that would seem to go against the argument that you're making. Am I mistaken in this?
Well, you have to think about that carefully. For example, the Constitution of Parliament, no government can change, the legislature can't change. The Senate, no government can change, has the power to change. Section 96, the power to appoint judges and the powers of judges, no legislature can change. A lot of water has gone under the bridge since 1910. And since the Charter has come up, the Supreme Court of Canada is quite able to say that the whole Charter has requirements that no legislature can change. So I think that you better have another look at that precedent and update it.
Could you give me 10 seconds? Because you introduced the session saying that you didn't want it to be a celebration about the success of the case and you wanted to have a healthy debate. So I wanted to thank the panelists for the debate. But I also want to take a second to thank the Canadian Constitution Foundation, everyone that was involved in the case, because I think we should celebrate. I think it was brilliant. So thank you to everyone.